Hello everybody, my name is Walter and this is episode 13 of my Hudson Component series. In this episode I will talk about minecart arrays and minecarts themselves. I will start with some general information about those blocks and entities, then I will go in detail of how they work, and then finally I'll give you a couple of examples of what they can be used for. So first things first, how can you get those minecarts and rails? Well, let's start with the rails. The rails you can find lying around in abandoned mineshafts or wooden mansions, at least the normal variant. The detector variant, powered and activator rails, you can find in abandoned mineshafts in chests. Of course, you can also craft all of those rails. For normal rails, it's 6 iron ingots and a single stick in the center, and you get a quarter stack out of that. For the detector rails, it's again 6 iron ingots, then a redstone dust and a stone pressure plate in the center. Here you only get 6 out of that. For the power rail, it's this time 6 golden ingots, 1 stick and 1 piece of redstone dust. Once more you get 6 out of that. And for the last type, for the activator rail, it's once more 6 iron ingots, this time 2 sticks and a redstone torch. Once more you get 6 out of that. That's the rails. Now for the minecarts. You will need to first craft normal minecarts out of 5 iron ingots. And if you want to go further, you can combine a normal minecart with either a furnace, a chest, a hopper, or a TNT block to get a corresponding furnace minecart, hopper minecart, chest minecart, and TNT minecart. Additionally, there are 2 more minecart types in the game, but you can only get them through commands. One is the command block minecart, and the other is the spawner minecart. The spawner minecart, by the way, only exists as an entity in the world. There is not even an item for the inventory implemented. If you break any of those 4 here, you will get not the chest minecart back, but you will get the minecart and the chest in separate pieces, corresponding for the other 3 types here. If something was inside of the chest, you will get that back too. If you break one of those 2, you will only get a minecart. And one interesting fact here, the chest minecart you can also find lying around in abandoned mineshafts. Following that, let's talk about the blocks themselves. So for the rails, and I mean basically all type of rails, you can place them on all blocks that have a complete upper surface or a complete upper edge or rim. So upside down steps, stairs, normal blocks, glass blocks, similar things, then hoppers, composters and also cauldrons. On all of those blocks you can place rails. To break a rail you can do this by hand or you can use a pickaxe, which is much faster. And what is also interesting about the rails is that they are very brittle blocks, meaning if you remove the block below them or if you push just the block below them, the rails will pop as an item, but the rails are also movable blocks, which is a very interesting combination, as we'll see in a few of those examples later on, which means that if you move a rail and it lands on a position where it could be placed, it will not pop as an item but stay as a block. The same is true if you move the rail and the block below the rail at the same time in the same direction. Again, the rail will stay as blocked then. And furthermore, the rails are not water resistant or lava resistant, so be aware of that. Next, let's talk about the size of a rail. So as you can see, the hitbox is 1/8 of a block high and a complete 1x1 footprint. So pretty much the same as a repeater or comparator. When rails are powered, like this powered rail here, they appear to emit light, but they don't actually produce any light. But they can let light through. And one special thing for the detector rail is that it actually connects to redstone wire and can redirect redstone wire. That's something the other types of rails don't do. Furthermore, the rails are directional blocks. Usually when you place them down, they are placed down in the direction you are looking at, like this rail here. But if there are other rails around them, that can change depending on what is around them. They can form, for example, corners or cross sections and similar things. So that heavily depends on their surroundings. Following that, let's talk about the minecarts. Minecarts can only be placed on top of rails. You can't just place it somewhere else. You need a rail and you need to click on that rail to place the minecart. You can also do this automatically using a dispenser. Once more, the dispenser also needs a rail. You can place several minecarts on the same spot. So here I have one minecart, here I have three minecarts, and you can see the shadow is much darker where I have more minecarts. Once you have placed it, it is more or less independent of the rail. It, of course, follows the rail, but it can also lie around without any rails below it. So you can remove the rails or just push it over the edge. And with that, let's talk about the minecart rails in more detail. First of all, what shapes are possible? Well, you can have a straight, flat shape, which can have two different orientations, of course. Then you can have a straight and ascending shape in four different orientations. And then you can have corners once more in four different orientations. The shapes themselves are actual block data. So here you can see this is, for example, a northwest corner. This here would be a north-south straight. And this here is, for example, an ascending north shape. So if a minecart rail changes shape, it can actually trigger an observer. Just this little side note there. But let's continue with the normal rails. The normal rails are the only rail type that can actually make corners. The other three types can only make straights and ascending straights, but no corners. If you have a cross junction and you place the rail in the center at last, it will prefer a corner shape and it will prefer the southeast directions. You can go around that by placing first the corner in or the rail in the center and then the rails around them. But if it's a T-junction and you start to power it, it will go back to a corner shape, and as you can see here, the connection in a T-junction is actually toggleable by powering or depowering the block in the center. If this is a cross-junction, so if I replace the lever here with another rail, even if the rail is not running into the junction here, this thing here thinks, okay, I'm a cross-junction, and stays frozen, so it will no longer react to redstone power. One important thing to know here. Next we have the detector rail. The detector rail I already talked about in my basic inputs episode quite some time ago, but here, just as a little reminder, let's go through it again. So when we have a detector rail and we place a minecart on top of it, it will power its surroundings and it will also strongly power the block below it with a signal strength of 15. If we remove the minecart, it stays turned on for another second. If we are using a comparator to take an output from the detector rail, it will detect the filling level of the minecart. That can, of course, only work with a chest minecart and a hopper minecart. It will also work with a command minecart, command block minecart. Here it will give you the result number or the positive result number of the last command execution. Next we have then the so-called powered rail. The powered rail, when it is not powered, will decelerate a minecart that is running over it and will most likely stop it within one or two blocks. If you power the minecart, the powered rail, the minecart will instead be accelerated in the direction it is currently moving in. If the minecart is standing still, it will wait until it gets a little bump, for example by the player, or when it goes down, it will then move downwards and then, of course, will be accelerated downwards. Or what is also possible is if you have on one side a full block, make sure this is a full block and not a transparent block, in that case you can also just power it and it will accelerate away from this terminal. The fourth type of rails is the so-called activator rail, and it activates minecarts. If it's a normal minecart and there is a player or a mob in there, the player or mob will be ejected from the minecart. If it's a command block minecart, the command block minecart will be triggered every 2 redstone ticks, so 5 times a second, and execute its command. If it's a hopper minecart and this activator rail is powered, it will deactivate the hopper minecart. If it's unpowered, it will reactivate the minecart. And finally, the TNT minecart will get primed when it runs onto a powered activator rail and explode after 4 seconds. Here a special case, when it is primed by an activator rail, it will not destroy the rails around it and the blocks directly below. Next, let's talk about so-called rail wire. So powered rails and activator rails are able to transmit the powered state for up to 7 blocks. So if I power this activator rail here, you can see that I am powering up to 7 activator rails in one direction. And if I go in the opposite direction, I can power up to 15 activator rails and also powered rails at the same time. It only works if they are connected and if it's the same type. So as you can see, this powered rail doesn't activate this activator rail and vice versa. Why is that such an interesting fact? Well, you can detect the change of the powered state with an observer. And that means that you can actually use this to transmit signals via wire over, of course, only 7 or 8 blocks. But what is interesting here is that the implementation in Minecraft is very simple concerning this powering. So the computer has to do very few calculations in the background, and that produces quite a bit less lag than if you had redstone wire, for example, in this orientation here. What is also interesting is that this whole thing here is movable, so this can also be implemented as part of a flying machine. And those two are reasons why people like Elmango use RailWire all the time in their enormous contraptions. There is a second use for RailWire, and that has to do with the already mentioned simple implementation. So I have powered 8 rails here. Now let's power this rail here, which is already powered, and you can see that nothing changes. The reason has to do with the simple implementation and means that those rails here don't regularly check whether they now can be powered. They wait for updates. So if I update any of those rails here, nothing happens because they see, okay, I have no power from either side. This rail here detects, okay, now I have to power up and then those here turn on. If you turn off the rail, we have the same situation. But now all of those here can detect a block update. So basically what you have here is a block update detector that can, if you are clever enough, be as long as you want and works just with rails. So this is one possible rail-based block update detector. Furthermore, detector rails can also be used to create block update detectors. For that you need a detector rail with a minecart on top of it, which of course powers the block below it, and thus this lamp here is turned on. If I now push the whole ensemble, you can see it should actually power this lamp, but it didn't update the surroundings. And only if I give it an update, you can see it will actually trigger the lamp. Same is true for the retraction. Once more, as you can see, the lamp is not updated correctly. So this is also a way to create block update detectors. I will show you an example for where this is used later on. And with that, let's talk about observer and bud interaction. Well, the interaction is pretty simple. Basically all active rail types and T-junctions for the normal rail type can actually trigger both. The only thing that is slightly special is if you have a detector rail here and you place a minecart on top of it, it will of course power the surroundings, and thus the block update detector will not really work as a block update detector anymore. But it technically is still an activation or trigger for a block update detector. Now with that we have reached the minecarts. Let's start with some channel information. So minecarts can be simply derailed by pushing them over the edge of a track. By the way, if you put several of those minecart rails next to each other, you get a track. And you can also derail a minecart by removing the track below it. You can re-rail it, rather simple, by simply pushing it on top of a rail again, or by it having a land on top of a rail. If you are sitting in a falling minecart and it lands on a rail, you won't get any falling damage, by the way. A minecart can be pushed around by simply bumping into it, or if you are sitting in it, you can also move it using the moving keys. The only problem here is that this is very slow and takes some time to actually rate. Minecarts themselves have a 1x1 footprint. The height depends on the type of minecart, and this means they will only fall through a hole if that is also 1x1. A simple ladder is enough to stop it from falling through, which is used in certain types of minecart-based elevators. You can place several minecarts, as you have seen in the beginning, on top of a simple or of the same minecart rail. Here I'm just using commands to summon in a rail, then I'm summoning in 3 minecarts, and then I'm removing the rail again. So now, since I have done this twice, I have 6 minecarts in the same position, just lying around. If I now give them a little bump, you can see they start to move in one direction, and only since they are now falling, they will slowly start to disassociate. But as you can see, minecarts that are put together start behaving slightly different and rather strange. This has to do with the fact that you can actually make trains out of minecarts, so you can put up to 4 minecarts together by simply pushing them into each other, which then can be combined, for example, with a furnace minecart to create a train, but more about this later on. Now, concerning the speed of a minecart, there is a hard upper limit, and so you can only go 8 meters per second in each cardinal direction. If you are going diagonally, so if you have a left corner, right corner, and so on, the minecart is actually moving diagonally with 8 times the square root of 2, so about 11.3 meters per second. And while the minecart can get faster than 8 meters per second, it can build up so-called momentum, meaning that when I accelerate it further and further, the momentum increases, and once I stop with the acceleration, the momentum slowly decreases, and only once the momentum has reached zero, the minecart starts to slow down. While we're talking about slowing down, well, the minecart slows down when it runs along rails. It slows down very quickly when it is running over either a depowered port rail or if it derails. And with that, let's talk about the normal minecart. The normal minecart is used to transport mobs and players, and it has enough space for exactly one entity. So here, for example, I have a slime in there, and if I click on it, you can see I won't be able to enter it. If I were to remove the slime, I can just get in here by clicking with the right mouse button on it, and to get out, all I have to do is to sneak. Mobs can sneak, of course, so they can only get out of it either if they are ejected using a powered activator rail, or if you remove the minecart itself. To get a mob into a minecart, all you need to do is to have the minecart running into the mob. So, empty minecart running over a track and mob standing on that will most likely end up with the mob being inside of the minecart. This is, by the way, also a reason that mobs usually try to avoid running onto tracks. If you are exiting a minecart or if an entity is ejected from a minecart, the minecart checks a 2x2x3 area around it for free space and tries to place the entity there. A north direction is preferred here, by the way. If it can't find any free space, the entity is placed right on top of the minecart. Interesting fact here. And minecart without any mobs or players in it will slow down quite a bit faster than if there is a player or mob in there, which is an interesting fact. And finally, you can also put boats into a normal minecart, which has some rather interesting results. Let's start with showing you a normal minecart in action. So I'm sitting in here and now I start to press the forward button and you can see it takes ages to get up to speed, and I'm very, very slow. Basically slower than I can actually walk. Now let's do the same with a minecart with a boat. I can't click on the minecart, but I can actually get into the boat. To get this configuration, you simply run a minecart into a boat. Now you can see I try to turn right, and now I turn left, and you can see my field of view is limited and my controls are actually inverted. So if I were to press forward, you can see I'm going actually backwards. But what you also can see, I'm very, very fast with this combination. So this is actually a way to use a rail without powered rails and still be rather fast. Just a little fun fact right there. Next up we have the Furnace Minecart, which was meant to be the train engine for minecart trains. Minecart trains can be put together by simply pushing several minecarts into each other, so they partially overlap, and then they tend to stick to each other, but this connection is not very strong and can be separated rather fast and easily. Nevertheless, the Furnace Minecart still is in the game and works by simply feeding it with coal or charcoal, and then it will run into one direction for 3 minutes at a constant 4 meters per second, even if it goes up or down. You can stack that, so you can feed it several times with coal, and you can also change the direction it goes by right-clicking on it. Since this interaction is completely manual and trains are not very fast, especially if you compare it to powered rails, I have never seen furnace minecarts used in any serious redstone circuitry. There are also thoughts to remove it at some point in the future, so the furnace minecart is, in my opinion, pretty much the most useless minecart of all of these here. Following that, we have the chest minecart. The chest minecart is basically just a single chest that you can move around. And this single chest is only 3/4 of a block high, which means that you can actually stack them in a more compact way than normal chests if you don't place them on a rail. If you place them on a rail, they will all snap into place in the same position, and you have a very compact way to store items, although separating them is a bit more tricky then. What is also interesting to know is that the fuller the chest inventory is, the faster it will slow down. Then we have the hopper minecart. The hopper minecart works similar to a normal hopper, just movable again, insofar that it collects items it runs over, but it can also collect items from the top of a block on top of it. A normal hopper wouldn't be able to collect items from the top of this full block here, but the hopper minecart can do that, which is very useful to know. A hopper minecart can be deactivated If it runs over a powered activator rail, at that point it will stop collecting items and will only restart it if it runs over a depower activator rail. Also important to know, it checks every game tick, so 20 times a second, for something to collect around it. So it's 8 times faster in the collection area than a normal hopper would be. And similar to the chest minecart, it also gets slower if it gets filled up. Next we have the TNT minecart, which is just a mobile explosion basically. It can be triggered in a multitude of ways. I already talked about it being triggered by a powered activator rail. Here it has a time of 4 seconds until it explodes, and it won't destroy the rails it is on top of. If it is triggered in any other way, it will also destroy rails. Other ways to trigger it are lava or fire, explosions in its surroundings, fire charges and flaming arrows, or being too fast and hitting anything. That can be the ground, if it's for example falling from more than 3 meters. That can be a player on the track, that can be a mob on the track, that can be another TNT minecart. It even explodes if it's too fast, running along a track from this direction here, along this corner, when you have a block here, because then it's basically hitting that block and once more exploding. So, very easy to trigger actually. And one thing you need to know here is that the explosion is bigger if the TNT minecart is faster. Now let's talk about the command block minecart. The command block minecart is basically a mobile command block. So it has more or less the same user interface as a normal command block. And although it looks like the impulse version of a command block, it's more similar to a repeat command block. It has a user interface where you can put in the command. And if it's standing on top of or running over a powered activator rail, it will execute that command every 2 redstone ticks, so 5 times a second. If you have it running over a detector rail with an outgoing comparator, you will get the command results as an output. So you will get how many positive executions the last command execution had. And that's the command minecart. Now let's get to the spawner minecart. The spawner minecart you also can only get through commands. And here it only works with the summon command, since there is no item you could put in your inventory. The spawner minecart works like a normal spawner, just that it can be moved around. What it spawns is determined by its NBT data and must be edited either while summoning it in or with the data command. Now let's talk about the rules concerning the movement of minecarts over rails. Normally, a minecart will follow a rail even around corners without issue. But there are situations like those junctions here, where one track ends and is crossed by another track. And here you will see that it doesn't depend from which direction you come. It will always go either in the south or east direction. So if you have such a cross section here, or cross junction, it will always try to go south or east. Of course, if it is the complete track here, it will just follow the track. If you have a T-junction, it will either follow the corner, or if it is derailing, it will go straight forward. The same is also true if it's falling on top of a corner. It will also go straight forward. If it is landing on top of a ascending straight, it will go down. And finally, if it is running along a corner which ends inside of a block, it will actually clip into the block. And that were the four rules concerning horizontal movement. Now let's talk about vertical movement. Here, there is a very big difference between moving up in ascending straight and moving down in ascending straight. When moving up, you can even jump through the edge between two diagonal blocks. But when you are going down, you need a too high headspace to go actually down. So you can see this here. What you will see now is that when I power this powder here, the minecart will go to this point, snap up to this position, and then start to move downwards. As you can see there. What you also could see, or here, was that the passenger here was getting a bit of damage because it was moving through this full block here. You can also see that the movement is obstructed by this block here. That is independent whether there is a passenger there or not. And only if I move this up, you can see it moving back in the opposite direction. What you also can see here is that at this point here, passenger and minecart separate a bit. And that is due to the fact that the minecart is not displayed in the proper position. Instead, what appears to happen is that the minecart snaps from this point down to this point. What actually happens is that it moves all the way over here, falls down, quickly snaps into place, and moves forward again. So, one important thing to know here is that the minecart is not always displayed in the correct position. Now let's talk briefly about the minecart speed itself. So the speed a minecart has at any given moment depends on quite a few factors. It depends on the type of the minecart, it depends on how full the minecart is, it depends on the rails it is running over, it depends on the surroundings, so going up, going down, around corners, whatever. It depends on how much momentum the minecart has saved up, other entities around it, and many, many other things. So this is a very complicated subject and I won't talk about it in detail in this video here. I will simply put a link for the corresponding video article in the description. Nevertheless, I will give you a couple of rules of thumb you can follow if you are building minecart tracks. The first is if you want to get from 0 to 8 meters per second, usually 3 powered rails should be enough. The second has to do with how many powered rails you need to go more or less infinitely at the maximum speed. If you are going just horizontally, you should have one powered rail every 27 blocks. If you go up, you need a powered rail every other block. And if you go down, you won't decelerate, you can just use normal rails. And with that, I finally come to the examples, so I will start with those for the TNT minecart. The TNT minecart can be used to build quickly acting TNT traps, drifting mines, and they can also, in theory at least, be used for mining. Although in those cases it is a lot cheaper just to use normal TNT. Anyway, let's talk about the drifting mine. So similar to before, I now have 6 TNT minecarts in one place, and if I give them a nudge, they will start to move in one direction. And at some point, they have built up enough momentum through their interaction that they will simply explode at the next interaction. They will explode much earlier if they simply run into any kind of obstruction. So as you can see, just running into a wall is enough for them to trigger. That's what I mean with a drifting mine. Now a quick acting TNT trap is something like this here, just a powered rail, then in this case I have 6 TNT cards on top of it, running into a derailing space with a block in front of it, and if I power this entire thing, I have less than a quarter second until it explodes. So much, much faster than the 4 seconds you would get with a normal TNT block. So the player has a lot less time to actually get out of the general area. Also, the explosion is very big. And during trying this out, sometimes I even removed a couple of blocks of those walls at the back there, so the explosion has a very big radius. And that's that for the TNT minecart. Now, for the normal minecart, you can obviously use it to transport the player around. So, there are various versions of minecart stations you can build. Some are able to select the direction you want to go, some are only terminals, some automatically eject you and reset the entire system. So, there are many, many ways. Furthermore, by combining detector and power drills, you can, for example, build one-way accelerators. So, if you come from this side, the detector rail will power the power drill, you can accelerate. If you come from this side, the power drill will be depowered and you will be slowed down. So, just a simple one-way accelerator here. Of course, using the normal minecart, you can also transport mobs. So, all I have is a dispenser here with minecarts, a track with a ejection point with an activator rail there, and as you can see, I can just move the mobs from this point to this point here. Let's continue with the hopper minecart. The hopper minecart is quite often used below farms, where it will be able to collect items through full blocks. So here you can see I have some drops, and if I simply power this, you can see now the drops getting collected, and so those hoppers here, they are then put into the chest down here. So, quite common way to build farms with the collection right below them. Another way to use hopper minecarts is to distribute items, for example in this super smelter design here, where we have those chests here. If you fill them with raw material and fuel, you can then simply distribute it more or less equally to those furnaces down here. On the other hand, chest minecarts usually are used as mobile storage. Here I have an automatic loader and unloading station. And basically what happens here is that this station here waits until this chest minecart is completely filled up. So let's put in the missing item here. As you can see, it's sent off and the unloader now waits until all items from this chest minecart have been put into this chest right there. And once that has happened, the whole thing is back in its original configuration. So you can actually transport items over mine tracks. And with that, let's get to the next example. This I already showed you somewhat earlier. So you can use chest minecarts as cyclable storage. So what you have here is a chest, and if you look in there and it doesn't contain what you're looking for, all you have to do is press the button and it cycles. And you can look in the next chest and so on and so on. So very simple storage system and pretty interesting to look at. Then we have the so-called bank systems. Here we have storage in form of chest minecarts, and what you can do is select one of those, which then would end up in some kind of terminal where you can interact with it. Then you send it back into the system and it gets sorted back into its correct or in the first empty space. Very easy to build, slightly difficult to design, but a very interesting use for those. Now we get to the more uncommon uses. So what you can do with rails is also so-called rails circuitry. So here just two examples. This here is an RS knowledge. And all I have to do is press this button to set it in this position where this stamp is on. If I press this button, this stamp here turns on. If I press this button again, nothing happens. So classical RS knowledge. You can also build T flip-flops, for example. So before observers were in the game and before the one tick feature of sticky pistons was introduced, those were quite popular in some places. Nowadays they are very big and clunky in comparison. Next up we have block update detectors. So this system here uses the fact that a detector rail can be moved around and also connects to redstone wire. to build a redirect block update detector. And since it's not using, for example, just a lamp as a detection point, but instead a rail, you can actually have an 8-block long block update detector, which, for example, can be triggered by a string, or, for example, by giving it any other kind of block update. Interesting enough, if you set this up correctly, you can, with just a bit of additional redstone, extend this entire thing. So now this entire line of rails here is one single block update detector, which can be quite useful. The only limitation here is basically that it can only go in a straight line. It can go up or down, but not around corners. Another rather interesting thing you can do with detector rails is using the butted state inside of a contraption like this here, which is commonly called a TNT duper. So basically what happens here is that the detector rail here was not placed with the minecart on top of it, but instead it was moved with the minecart on top of it in this position. As mentioned before, this creates a block update detector. Now what happens when I move the entire thing is that it first updates this one here, the TNT gets triggered. At the same time, the whole thing moves over and the TNT is also moved, and thus we get a duplication happening. So very interesting and quite commonly used for this kind of setup. And the last thing is that you can actually use them as part of flying machines, not only to move a minecart along, but also to control it. This design here was recently shown by Elmango, and what you have here is a flying machine that when you're using the minecart here and go to this direction, it will move forward. If you go in the opposite direction, it will start to move backward. And if you go in the center, it will simply stop to move. So a very, very interesting concept right there. And with that, we have finally reached the end of this episode about minecart arrays and minecarts. I hope I was able to explain to you how they work and what you can do with them. I also hope you enjoyed this little episode, and well, see ya!